time I open the car and get in, I start feeling this is my dad's car. As I drive, I really feel like, what was my dad thinking when he was driving? How did he feel? Did he know how to use all the buttons and the switches? Because I didn't change those settings, so I would listen to the radio settings to see what he was listening to. I would really just put myself in his shoes when I'm driving that car. And sometimes I would have maybe a new perspective of life that I would have because that he would experience too when he was driving. So certainly very surreal, very much of a nostalgic kind of feeling. There's quite a connection. Hi, I'm David Lee, and this is my father's Phantom One Rolls-Royce. I bought him in 2005. My father, Hing Wa Lee, was born in 1947. It was a difficult time in China when the communists came about with the Red Army. People that were educated, people that were landowners, they were all taken away from their families to a concentration camp to be reprogrammed. My father tried to be a farmer and grow and produce and sell, but that was not so successful. So they agreed and devised a way to escape to Hong Kong because at that time they heard that people were finding work and be able to send money home. The way to escape was to be smuggled onto a boat that was going on a way to Macau. It was very risky and very dangerous to jump out and then swim to shore. So thank goodness my father and his brother did make it. So my uncle was 15, my father was 13, they got to Hong Kong. Now in those days to find work, you had to be an apprentice. My uncle became an apprentice for suit making, and my father was an apprentice for a gemstone carving master. A lot of people stayed for 3 years, he stayed for 5 years. Came out and started his own factory. He was 18 years old. Now they also had a showroom on the Tsim Sha Tsui side, which is across the Victoria Harbor. To get where he had a store, his gallery, you would walk across and you would see on the left side the Peninsula Hotel. The Peninsula Hotel was the most elegant hotel in Asia. The Peninsula was famous for buying a fleet of Rolls Royce. So my father was telling me you would see the green Rolls Royces in front. And that was just the idea that, wow, eating there, staying there meant that you're a successful person. Driving a Rolls Royce, owning one would even be more of a success story. But he would never buy one himself. He was always thinking for his family. He wanted to build the wealth for his family. When a person grew up very poor, even now they can afford it, it's hard for them to buy it. But I thought he deserved it. You know, he worked so hard for all these years and provided for our family. And we grew up like a middle-class family. We weren't super wealthy. In 2005, Rolls-Royce came out with a new Phantom. At that point, they owned my BMW. They used a V12 BMW engine. And I said, you know what? I want to buy that car and give it to my dad so that he cannot say anything about it, like, you know, because he wouldn't buy it himself. And I remember when he first got it, he was so happy. He couldn't believe it. But more important is that when he was telling his friends, he would be so proud to say that you provided and taught your son and that he would buy it and give it to me. He felt like there was a success in teaching the next generation. So he was very proud of that. And mainly I was just happy that he was happy. I also was a little nervous. Would I get yelled at for spending this amount when he didn't ask me to do it? But I took the chance. Now when he did receive it, there was a lot of emotions, a lot of deep sentiment in that experience. So it was very emotional. For him, the many years of walking across Salisbury Road, seeing the peninsula, seeing the Rolls Royce there, the slow ingraining of what is considered luxury, what is a goal. And many of the Hong Kong people had the same idea. It really meant something so much deeper than this gift of this Rolls Royce to my father than any other gift that maybe he might have liked. He had passed away from cancer. And I remember in the time that he was going through treatment and talking to him that, you know, really that he wanted to make sure his family was okay. And that I said, you know, don't worry, Dad. Well, you know, I'll make sure everything is fine. Even when he came from China, he made not a lot of money, but he said he sent everything back to China for his mom, for his younger brother and sisters. That's how he is, you know. He would take care of others first. And he always taught me to take care of your younger brother, younger sister first, take care of your mom. Make sure everybody is well taken care of before you start to take care of yourself. That had been what he taught me, that had been what his example in life was, that's what he did and learned. So, no, definitely it was part of his character. When you lose your father, it's one of those things that affects you so much psychologically. Only time will help a little bit, but it would never be enough time. I remember I was driving home one day and I was talking to my mentor and I was saying, boy, I really miss my dad, and I feel that I'm always self-driven to trying to do something to always remember him, that he would be proud. My mentor said, when I lost my father maybe 20 years ago, I still find myself thinking, will he be proud? So, you know, these things don't ever leave. It's just part of coping, and yes, time helps, but you're never the same. For me to have another reminder, and even more of a physical reminder of my father in this car, it just, there's more comfort in that. There's more comfort for sure.